Today I have a very special guest. I have Frits Damrow, the former principal trumpet of the Royal Concertgebouw Orchestra. And before we get started, I want to thank my sponsors for today, Dylan Music. You can see them on the web at dylanmusic.com. And please feel free to give them the code DOOLIN5 and you'll get a 5% discount on anything you purchase there. And also to Euclid IQ, who is the world's leader in audio and video compression technology. So without any further ado, thank you, Frits, so much for being here. And it's a pleasure to see you. Yeah. You know, it's funny, in researching your background, I've always known who you were and loved your playing, but there's not as much information on your background. a little bit. I have found some things. But I wonder if you could talk about your beginnings as a trumpet player, when you started and who your first teacher was.
Mm-hmm. So I started in the local wind band. I was born in the south part of the Netherlands. And in this area, it's very well known for their the majority of really very good wind bands. And I started there not on a trumpet, but on a flugelhorn, because the flugelhorn in the Dutch-speaking areas is a very important instrument in the wind bands. So I started on the flugelhorn, and actually my first teacher was the conductor of the band. And I must say, I owe this person a lot. He was extremely musical man, and maybe he didn't know so much about technique, about, you know, basics, but he used the music in a way to overcome all the technical issues and technical problems. And, you know, he had more really good young students who became professional players later. So he was a gifted and talented teacher. Yeah. And then later I went to the music school, and then I went to the conservatory in Maastricht, which is the capital of the province in the South Netherlands. So this is how I started. And then after a couple of years, I went to a summer camp in Switzerland. And there was a summer camp with James Stamp and Thomas Stevens. And I was 19 years old. And I had no idea who these guys were. I had no idea. The only information at that time, I'm talking about 1978, 1979, so more than 40 years ago. The only information source I had here in Europe was the Brass Bulletin, the magazine that was published four times a year by Jean-Pierre Mattès, the publisher of the BIM edition. Yeah, and that was the only access we had to information, to interviews, to ads and this kind of things. And there was an ad about this summer course in Switzerland. So I went there and I was 19 years old. And I must say, this experience, having lessons with Tom Stevens and James Stamp, that was like arriving at a completely different planet, you know, because I learned things I never heard about before. You know, we had to play on the mouthpiece. We played pedal notes and bending notes and this system about basics. And it was, you know, it was extremely, extremely exciting experience for me. Yeah. This first time having lessons with these guys. And then, you know, then I thought, this is what I want. And then later I had more lessons with Tom Stevens and with James Stamp. Then afterwards I went to Paris to Pierre Thibaud. Yeah, I had private lessons with Pierre Thibaud. But at that time I already had my first job as principal trumpet in the Radio Symphony Orchestra. So I went down to Paris every couple of weeks to have a private lesson with Pierre Thibaud. But I must say my foundation I really learned that from James Stamp and Tom Stevens. Yeah, so these two teachers had a huge influence on my development and on my playing, and actually on so many things I do now and I know now. So, and I must say, this first experience were more than 40 years ago, but it's still so fresh in my memory, as if it was last week. Yeah, so that big impression they made on me, and this influence they had on my career and my development.
But you said you were 19 when you saw them first. Were you? You must have been developed in some way, because you got a job only 2 years after meeting them.
Yes. I think I could play the trumpet, and in the Netherlands I won some music competitions as a young player, so obviously I had some talent for the instrument. But you know, I didn't know anything. I had no idea how to practice, and just did something. I had no plan. I had no structure. There was nothing. I had to learn everything from the bottom on. And I think Stamp did a really good job in organizing my practice, and he showed me what to practice and how to practice and how long, and also Tom Stevens, who I think was an extremely intelligent, smart person. And he could be very direct. He could be very confrontating, almost. But you know, I learned everything he said was absolutely true, and I learned so much from both of them. And I think from that moment on, my playing became so much more structured and organized. And then I knew how to practice and what to practice.
What was so when you said you had more lessons with Stevens, did you come to the States for those, or was this?
Yeah.
So you came over to. So very similar to Håkan in that way.
Yeah. Yes.
Right. Now, were you and Håkan at the same clinics in the summers with Jean-Pierre Mathez, or
I met Håkan several times, also in Paris, because Håkan also went to Paris to Pierre Thibaud. Right. So we met each other sometimes there. And I think this combination of teachers, having Stamp and Stevens on the other side, and as a next step, I remember that Tom Stevens said to me, "And now you have to go to Thibaud." I think, because Håkan did kind of the same order and the same idea. And you know, compared to Thibaud, Stevens was a pussy, because Thibaud was really extremely tough, and he was extremely direct. But you know, he helped me a lot. He was also for me a great teacher. He was in his teaching. He was very organized. He knew exactly. He said, "When you have problems with articulation, take the Arban, this exercise, play like this, and then you take this book, you do this exercise, practice like this." So he had systems for every problem, and it was very structured and was extremely organized.
Yeah.
And you know, it was a next dimension. And you know, Thibaud really, he learned us that we have to work hard. Without hard work, nothing happens. And he was really insisting on practicing and playing. And you know, he really kicked our asses every lesson. And that was exactly what I needed. And also Thibaud, I owe him a lot. He was a big influence on also my mentality and my you know, my resistance and my, you know, Håkan said many times, "If you survive Thibaud, you can deal with any situation." And in the music industry. And you know, I can imagine this. So after having lessons with Thibaud, all the, you know, the intimidating conductors, they don't hit you as hard as they want to.
So also, was Thibaud doing Caruso at this time with you?
I didn't do Caruso with Thibaut, but I know that he was doing Caruso with many other players.
Right. Yeah.
You know, with Thibaut, I did more a continuation of stamp style studies, and Thibaut, he changed it into his own ideas, and it was also he added a little bit of Claude Gordon style of exercises, yeah, and of course a lot of Clark and lip flexibilities, a lot of Arban, yeah, in combination with the Chailly studies and the French the trumpet concertos. So it was a combination of all yeah, the important things you have to learn.
When you were with Thibaud, first of all, did you meet Stephen Burns, by the way, at this time too?
Yes, yeah.
Yeah. Because I know he was seeing Thibaud quite a bit at that time.
Yeah.
When you were with Thibaud, was it always a private lesson, or was it ever like the full class that he would do?
I was a private student. So okay. Mostly I went to his house. He lived in Saint-Denis in the north part of Paris, and he was living there in a bungalow, and in his basement he had his teaching studio. So okay. Mostly I went there. But sometimes he took me in the afternoon, he took me to the conservatory. Then we went teaching to the conservatory, and I said, yeah, come with me, you can join the class. And that was quite a interesting experience. He could be extremely tough to the students. It was sometimes, yeah. I felt sorry for the students, you know, how tough and how direct and how demanding he was. But he also was demanding for himself, yeah. And he didn't take care about himself, not at all. He was a very hard worker and with a lot of energy. And I remember his private lessons. Sometimes the lesson was 2 or 3 hours, yeah. And then I wanted to pay him 2 or 3 hours of lesson. He said, you know, 1 hour is, I don't remember how much it was for each hour. So I wanted to pay him 3 hours, and then he said, no, you only play 1 hour. Yeah, that's my decision. So he didn't do this for the money. He just did it to help the student. And so actually he although he could be brutal, he was not a bad person, not at all.
He had an intention.
He had an intention by teaching in this way, yeah, because I think you were armed really very well to face more difficult situations in the orchestra or wherever.
Yeah. And going back to Stevens a little bit, I think if people never were lucky enough to spend a little time around Stevens, they might only associate Stamp with him. But Stevens had a way of talking about rhythm that I think, or thinking about some of the musical ideas that maybe some people don't really know. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yes. Yeah. He was extremely precise. Yeah. And I remember that during a lesson, I said to him, I made a mistake. According to him, I made a rhythmical mistake. And I remember I said to him, I don't feel this rhythm quite well. And he said, you shouldn't feel rhythm, you should count rhythm. Yeah, so we, and yeah, that was a very simple, very simple statement, but very true, very true.
Yeah.
Yeah, I learned so many things from Stevens. What he said many times was, look behind the notes, look what is really there. Maybe you know this book with the Concone studies he published,
yes,
with his changing meters. Yeah,
yes.
And I know that he also had very simple Arban exercises. and he rewrote this in changing meters. And you played ta-da-dum, ta-da-dum, pam-pam-pam, ta-da-dum, but you played with 3/8 and 4/16 and 5/8 and 7/8. So you played the same melody, but in completely different meters. And he wanted to show us that you have to look behind the notes, what is really there. And also his Concone studies. It's still the same study, but it's written in a different way. And it's very confusing in the beginning. But I think this is typical. This was typical Stevens. Was a very smart way to deal with music, and he was extremely smart guy. I learned so much about him, and he was also very hardworking. He was always practicing and playing, and he was so critical about his own playing. He many times said, don't be a cowboy. Yeah, he was always a little bit critical about people who don't think and they just play and they have no idea what they do and how to do. So he was quite critical about these guys. Yeah, and I also remember that he said several times, you should know when to stop. Yeah, don't try to be a next Bud Herseth, because he didn't agree on this, to stay in the orchestra forever. And that's what Tom Stevens himself did. Yeah, he officially resigned from the LA Philharmonic, I think when he was 58, 59. And then he stayed as a freelance principal player. And he told me, he said, I can quit any week I can quit because I have no permanent contract anymore. And he wanted to be free to quit in any given moment where he thought he couldn't reach this level of playing anymore. And he was very critical about this, to always play on an extremely high level.
Yeah.
I remember when I got the job in the Concertgebouw Orchestra, I called him, to tell him I won the job in the orchestra. And the only comment he said, it was like, now you have to swim with the sharks. that was his comment.
That sounds like Tom. That's very funny. That's very funny. And all those things you said are so true. I did those rhythmic studies with him and Armin, and it can be pretty embarrassing when you think that you can count and then you find out not according to him. And and also, when we're thinking about Tom, you also think about his all the solo playing he did and all the new music and all of that. Yes. So
Yeah, you know, I think he was so much ahead of his time, and I remember I asked him why he did so much of this contemporary repertoire, and his explanation was somebody has to do it, and at that time, I talk about 45 years ago, almost nobody played this repertoire. He was one of the really very few in the whole world, really being so serious about the contemporary repertoire. And I think if you listen today, if you listen to his recordings, these recordings, they sound so up to date and so fresh and so impressive that it could have been recorded last week. Yeah, if you listen to his Hänsel Sonatine, I think for me it's still the best there is. Yeah, and if you also the more conventional repertoire, I always liked his Hindemith Sonata extremely much, because he was so strictly to the text. Yeah, and I remember that I played the Hindemith Sonata for him, and he was extremely precise about, about the dynamics, about the rhythm, about everything. And he really insisted on being extremely precise. And maybe he was not the most romantic player in the world, but he was extremely professional. He was an absolute, extremely professional, very serious musician. So I think he was an example. I admired him a lot, and also his playing in the orchestra, his sound and his presence and his, you know, his character was.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was maybe not the easiest person on the planet, and but I must say he was absolutely top player at that time.
Yeah. Yeah. And were you, when you would come over to see Stevens, were you seeing Stamp in the same trips, I assume?
Yeah, yes, yeah. I did, yeah.
Talk a little bit about Mr. Stamp's demeanor and what he was like for people that never got a chance to meet him.
Mm. Yeah, you know, Stamp was like a grandfather. He was so nice and so polite and so respectful, yeah. I remember one lesson, he asked me, did you make an appointment with Tommy for the lessons? And I said, no, not yet. Okay, so let's call Tom. Yeah. And he called Tom Stevens to make an appointment for a lesson for me. And then I could hear that he said, Tommy, don't be too hard on the boy. Yeah. So he was very nice, but, I think he knows so well about the basics of the trumpet playing, how to practice his exercises. And, you know, I think the most interesting exercises in the Stamp book are in the second part. Yeah. And everybody is playing this number 3A, this basic warming up. But, you know, there are much more interesting and great exercises, and also his way to deal with the Herbert Clark technical studies. Mm-hmm. It was very complete. His method was very complete about sound, about attacks, about endurance, about high notes, low notes, flexibility, velocity. You know, it was a really complete program that covers all the aspects of trumpet playing. And yet it was a very extremely simple approach. It was very easy to understand. And I think that was the power of his teaching. It was so simple and so easy and so efficient. Yeah. And I remember that he said, it's very easy to make teaching complicated. Yeah. And I think he was absolutely very true about this.
Yeah. What parts of the Stamp book outside of the beginning of it do you find later in the book that you've used the most?
I think the exercise with the chromatic scales where you play ta 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 da 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 ta ta, this attack, this air release, yeah, to find a good start and a good sound on the beginning notes. Mm-hmm. And I think the supplementary studies, the irons.
The irons,
I deal with this beginning, this body, body, da 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 da, yeah, to make the air flow with the syncopations and to stabilize the rhythm using your fingers. Yeah, so this very simple ideas, I think it brought a lot of improvements in my playing.
Yeah, yeah. And that's obviously, I mean, we'll get into your books in a little bit, but it's very clear the Stamp influence in all the books that you've written as well. You know, it's you've taken it and put even another spin on it. Was Stamp still playing in your lessons at that point?
Yes, he did. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And you know, he was, what I remember, he was a very elegant player. Yeah. He almost sounded like a flute with this elegance. Yeah. And he never played loud, and yeah, he was the organization and the precision he was teaching his students, he still could show it on the trumpet, although he was 70 plus. Yeah, he was over 70.
And you were talking about when you first met them and you said you didn't know very much. I mean, obviously you could play pretty well, but what did you notice were the changes that happened when you started playing in the pedal register and how that influenced your sound and your playing? What was that, if you remember that experience?
Yes, I think I noticed immediately what it did to my playing. Yeah, in terms of more flexibility, a more open resonant sound, better high register, an overall better balance in my playing, and also a better coordination. So from the first moment on, when I started to do these exercises, and of course it was perfect that I had lessons with Tom Stevens and with James Stamp, you know, and in these 2 weeks, yeah, one day I had a lesson with Tom, one day I had a lesson with Jimmy Stamp. So this experience was great, and it was so supplementary, this two ideas, because Tom was also a Stamp student, so he knew exactly on the solo repertoire. Yeah, it was like an extension of what James Stamp was doing.
Right. And you have, for people that don't know, that you have a lot of videos on YouTube where you demonstrate a lot of things, the Frits Damrow Trumpet Academy. Maybe they can have some English subtitles, but I watch them. I know what you're going after. I did want to ask, the thing that you often do on there that I really like, that I've tried to incorporate in my own playing, is when you blow fully outside of the... Was that something you picked up from Stamp, or is that something you kind of noticed?
No, not. You know, over the years, I also added different ideas to my playing. For example, the Chikowitz, the flow studies, which I think are absolutely great. Yeah, and also I used Maggio, this kind of exercises. I wanted to avoid doing the same thing for decades again and again and again. So maybe also what we were talking about in the beginning of our conversation, that sometimes I become a little bit impatient, and I feel the need to change or to adapt something without changing the basic system. Yeah, but I think the emphasis on from the Stamp method, it's a lot of work on the embouchure, on precision and coordination here. And I think the combination with Chikowitz flow studies, I think it's a perfect combination.
Yeah, and those are available, if anybody's watching, at studio259productions.com. it's my commercial.
I use them a lot. I use them a lot, the flow studies, with my students. Yeah. They all play flow studies. Absolutely. Great stuff.
So that's, I love hearing that. And what is your daily routine like now, if today? Like, what would be your warm-up regimen that you would do now?
Yeah, so I start with breathing exercises. I do this more than I used to do, because I feel when you get older that your lung capacity is not as big as it used to be. So I have to train my lungs and my breathing system more than when I was younger. So I start doing some breathing exercise. Then I do a little bit of lip buzzing, a little bit of mouthpiece playing, but just a little bit. And then I move into some basic exercises, which can be very different. Sometimes I just start with Stamp exercises. Sometimes I start with Chikowitz flow studies, or I do other from my own, from my shape up book, with combined with bendings. Yeah, so I try to change a little bit. The concept is always the same, but I use different material, and it also keeps my mind awake, and it stimulates my focus and my concentration. Because I don't like the expression routines. Because I think a routine is a repeating process. I tried when I do my warming ups, I tried also to practice. It's not just warming up, but I want to get the best possible result. Yeah, so I want to be very motivated, and I want always to play my best possible sound. So it's always a it's a process, yeah, and yeah. And it's not a routine. I think that's for me. I want to avoid playing in a routine like way where maybe the brain is completely not connected to what the body is doing. Yeah? I think that's wasteless.
How much time do you normally spend in that first session of fundamentals, warming up, however people want to call it?
About 40, 45 minutes. Yeah, it could be shorter, but I like to play when I have enough time. I like to, 40, 45 minutes. And actually then I'm ready to go.
Yeah. Now, is that similar when you were in the orchestra?
To my idea, I need a little bit longer now. Yeah. I remember when I was young, I still did my warming ups because I learned this from Stamp and from Pierre Thibaud, but I didn't need it that much as I need it now. Yeah. Right. I think, when you get older, also I had a heart attack about 4 years ago, and I must say that really put me down quite seriously in my playing. Yeah. Wow. Also in my mentality. So to realize that you are vulnerable and things can happen to your body just in a split second. Yeah. And recovering from this heart attack, I must say I struggled extremely much. I couldn't play anymore. I was very close to give up my playing. Because my whole body felt completely different in this recovery after this heart attack. And little by little, it came back, but I had to practice extremely, extremely hard. It was a great experience and a great test, to see what I was able to improve in my playing and how I could get back to playing on a good level.
How long did you wait to start playing after the heart attack?
Actually, again, I was a little bit impatient, and so I remember the heart attack was in August, and I played my first concerts in December, so 3-4 months later.
Wow. Yeah, that's pretty quick after a heart attack.
Yeah. But I remember I didn't feel well. I didn't feel well during this concert. I was very also I was a little bit insecure about my playing, but it was a way to get back because I thought you cannot wait forever to test yourself.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So maybe it was helpful. I don't know. I can't say, but
well, everybody's glad you survived the heart attack.
Yeah, we all have our problems. I know that maybe you heard the story about Tom Stevens with his dog. Yeah, he split his lip completely, and his Doberman hit him. Yeah, while he was fighting with another dog, and also Tom Stevens, he already gave up, and he started studying to become a lawyer. Yeah, so.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's what he did. Yeah, so he said, "Well, I, he never expected that he could get back as a player. Yeah,
I would never want to try a case against Tom Stevens in a courtroom.
I think that would be a tough one, yeah.
But not as tough as if Thibaut became a lawyer, apparently.
Yeah, oh my God. He would win any case, yeah.
Okay. Let's talk about your orchestral career a little bit. One question I did have about the training, though, because of where the conservatory where you went, it sits sort of in the middle of France and Germany, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So could you talk about the training? Would you say schools, were they influenced by one area more than another area, or was it?
Yes. It was much more influenced by the French style of playing. Also because my teacher there, he studied in Belgium, and he studied with a student of Theo Charlier, Pierre Cox. Pierre Cox, he was a trumpet player in Liège in Belgium, and he was a student of Theo Charlier. So the whole, also the repertoire was mostly French, what we did. And we also played on piston valve, C trumpets most of the time. We didn't use any rotary valves at that time. Not at all. So okay. the German influence was extremely limited.
What was your teacher's name there, by the way?
Pierre Wilhelmus.
Okay.
And he was the principal trumpet of the city orchestra in Maastricht for many years.
Okay. Okay. So mostly French. That included like solfege, I assume, things like that,
yes.
Musicianship classes.
Yeah.
Right.
So I think also the solfège classes we had in the conservatory in Maastricht were quite orientated on the Belgian schools. We had to sing in different keys. Yeah, so the solfège was very hard. I remember I had 3 hours of solfège with two students, 3 hours of singing and in different keys and. So was a very tough but I think for trumpet players it's absolutely great to have an education like this on solfège.
Yeah, and because your teacher studied with a student of Charlier, that probably gave you a unique insight into that book that some people probably don't have.
We did. He had some. Yeah, almost first-hand information or second-hand information from Pierre Cox, his teacher. Yeah, and but at that time I didn't realize how special it was to have this direct connection to this etudes and the solo pieces of Théo Charlier. You know, I didn't realize it, and now I think, wow, that was special, you know, because the whole trumpet world is playing the Charlier studies, and I was so close to the source, I was so close to the composer.
Yeah. Now I know that you said there was a lot of C trumpet playing at that time. Were you playing the Charliers on B flat or C trumpet?
C trumpets. We played them on C trumpets. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just like Håkan is doing in his videos.
Yeah, those videos are unbelievable, right? They're so great.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you, when you hear people play Charlier, because you have that close connection to it, that you feel like you have a little more insight on than most people? Is there like any particular etudes where you think, oh, that's not quite the same? Or
yes. You know, the way Håkan is playing this studies, I think it's very special and it's very personal, and I think there is only one person who can play them like this, and that's Håkan.
Yes.
Because he has this great personality, and he has this, you know, this willpower, and he has this taste, and he has this ideas and this imagination to make the etudes really sound like a extremely exciting piece of music. Yeah, and I think that's a great way to play these studies and also to listen to these studies. On the other hand, I remember that my teacher said many times, you should also think about these etudes like being solfège studies. You know, because it many studies, they have the title about intervals, about thirds or fourths and fifths and sixths. So there is a system based on solfège in the follow-up in the studies. So this aspect as being solfège exercises, I think it's a very can be a very helpful idea to include this in the practice concept when you practice the studies.
Wow.
I also remember that I had to sing many times. I had to sing. My teacher said, stop playing, sing the next line. Sing this four bars, and then we had to sing, and they say, okay, this note is not good, this interval, you missed this interval, sing again. And he really insisted that we could sing in tune, and then the playing became so much easier. So he really used this etudes like being solfège studies without ignoring the musical impact this studies can have.
Now that's that I've never thought of them as solfège studies, but it does make sense with the system there. Well, let's talk about a little about your orchestra playing. So you started, you got a job when you were 21 with the Netherlands Radio Orchestra, and you were there for 9 years, right? Can you talk about, I mean, because if you said you didn't know certain things when you met Stamp and Stevens and Thibaud, you learned a lot of literature very quickly, I assume, on that job.
So I was quite young, and I'm still grateful to the players in the orchestra then that they really gave me this opportunity to become a principal trumpet player in a big orchestra, being so young and being so unexperienced. So it was but I must say, especially in a radio orchestra like this, we had to play a lot of repertoire. We played, there were recordings and there were concerts, and we also did chamber music, and we played also the lesser known repertoire. I think the for me that was the best orchestra to start with, because I learned so much. I could develop myself so well over the years because of the repertoire, because we did chamber music, and we did many different settings, and we played also opera. We played a lot of contemporary music as well. So it was a very broad repertoire we had to cover then. And I think that was a great time. Was very, very interesting time for my further career.
Were there while you were learning all this repertoire, were there other orchestras or players that you found yourself coming back to more often to study as you were learning new material?
You mean some teachers I visited
Oh no, I mean
then?
like what orchestras were you listening to as you were learning the repertoire? Who were
Ah,
you modeling?
ah. You know, even when I started to study, when I was 16, 17 years old, I bought many records from the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. All these records with Fritz Reiner, all the stuff, all the Stravinsky and all the Respighi, and the spectacular orchestral repertoire. So actually, very soon the Chicago Symphony was my favorite orchestra, and I listened to this orchestra many, many, many times. So it had a great influence on also what I thought a good trumpet section, a good trumpet player should sound like. Because there was no internet, there was no YouTube. We didn't have this easy access to listen to any orchestra, to any player. So we had to be selective in a way. We could not listen to anything because it was just not available. And when I started to play in the Radio Symphony Orchestra, there was a Dutch trumpet player. He was a freelance player, and he was actually he was buying and selling trumpets. He was, trading trumpets and mouthpieces, and he had a lot of connections in the U.S. His name is Jos Kieft, and in the Netherlands, every trumpet player knows this name. He was very typical guy, but he gave me many times. He gave me records from also from. He said, "You have to listen to Gilbert Johnson, Philadelphia Orchestra. Listen to his vibrato." And then he came up with a different. He said, "You have to listen to Armando Guitala, the Boston Symphony." And he gave me many records to listen to. So I must say he helped me a lot to open my horizon and to listen to so many great players. But it was basically all American orchestras I listened to. I remember I bought some records from the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra, and at that time in the late 70s, I didn't like this orchestra. I didn't like this sound. It was not my taste. It didn't match my taste, my idea. So I can say that somehow I have a really French American education. So this mix And I think you also know that the American style of playing is influenced hugely by French players like Georges Majer, yeah, or Roger Voisin. You know, these were French, great French players. Yeah, and
right.
Moving on to Herset. Yeah, so there is a direct connection from the French playing into the American orchestral trumpet playing.
Right, that's why we play so much C trumpet. Yeah, here because of those people, you know.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
hopefully we miss less notes because of that. So, can I talk about the job at Concertgebouw? Do you remember the audition?
Yes, I do.
And what was the process like? Was it a committee voting, or was it the whole orchestra listening, like it is in Germany sometimes? Or
no, there was a committee. I think about 25 people, brass section, and then leaders of all the groups, including string players.
25 people on a committee, though.
Yeah, yeah. And there was, I remember there was first round behind the screen, and I had to play the Haydn concerto first and second movement, and some orchestral excerpts. I remember I had to play Petrushka, Pictures, Mahler 5, and the posthorn solo. That was the first day, the first round.
Yeah.
And then I think three or four players went on to the next round, which was, I think, the next day. And then we had to play the Tomasi concerto, the first movement with cadenza. And then there was a list of orchestral excerpts.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think this audition took maybe 40 minutes altogether. I had to play. Yeah.
And that was Chailly was the music
and
director.
And I remember in this audition, I also had to play Charlier study, the second study I had to play also.
Wow.
Yeah.
On C trumpet?
On C trumpet, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So, and Riccardo Chailly was the music director then, is that right?
Yes, yeah.
So did he make the final decision, or was it more the committee?
The conductor only had one vote, just like all the others. Yeah, so the chief conductor cannot insist on a certain player, or he cannot boycott a certain player. So the orchestra as a unit has the main voice, the main decision.
Yeah, that's good. Do you remember the feeling when you found out you won?
Yeah, it was great. I couldn't believe it. Yeah, but yeah, but you know, I must say, my preparation for this audition, now I think was extremely good, because for months I canceled many jobs, many gigs, yeah, and I only focused on this audition, yeah, and I still played in the Radio Symphony Orchestra. I remember that many times I stayed in the studio, in the big studio, and I practiced. I stayed until 11, 12 in the night, and I practiced in this big hall, because I knew I had to do this audition also in the Concertgebouw. So to get used to play in a big room. So, and I remember that the day of the audition, I really felt ready. Yeah, I had this idea. Okay, let's go. So I think my preparation worked out quite well. Yeah, and I think all those lessons with Stevens and all those lessons with Thibaud, there was the moment where I really could put things together and make things work and do the ultimate test about everything I learned. Yeah, can I really put this into practice, and can I really make it until my highest level of playing, being good enough to compete in an audition for the Concertgebouw? Yeah, and I think that's Yeah, that's the only way. That's the only way you should go to an audition. You should have the feeling that you are competitive. Yeah, maybe not winning the audition, but you should feel strong and you should feel, you know, convincing enough to know that you could make a difference in this audition. And if you don't have this feeling, then I think you shouldn't go. You shouldn't do this.
Well, speaking of that, I'm sure obviously your physical preparation was good, but talk about your mental preparation also. Were there books that you read or ways that you wrapped your mind around trying to be ready for that task, like Inner Game of Tennis and books like that?
Yeah. Yes, I did. Yeah, I've always been interested in books that deal with the mental issue, like you say, this Galway, this in the Inner Game of Tennis or the Inner Game of Skiing. Or there was another book I liked a lot by Danny Millman. It's the Total Athlete. It's the name, and it also deals with this this mental process. Yeah, I think it helped me a lot to understand, you know, what Galway is talking about in this Inner Game of Tennis. That, you know, this conversation you start with this small devil in your mind, yeah, and yeah, this discussion you should try to avoid. Yeah, I must say it helped me a lot. And I also did I tried some yoga or some other Alexander technique. I tried many different things to have a better balance between the body and the mind. Yeah, and I think everybody should try to find what works for him or her, because we are all different. We all have different needs. Some have a lot of tension in their head, some other have a lot of tension in their body, or both. Yeah, so, and I think that's what we have to find out to help each other. But you know, I'm very happy. This is what I talk about my students also many times, that today it's accepted to say that you are nervous and to say that you are a little bit, yeah, that you feel stress and that you're struggling with your mind and with your focus. And you know, in early days it was like a taboo, you know, this issue. Yeah. They didn't talk about it. Yeah. And also my teacher was a good teacher, I think, but you know, he had no idea about this. And he only said, when you're nervous, you didn't practice enough. Yeah.
Yeah, that's not always true.
That's not always true.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I want to talk about the Concertgebouw a little bit, because it's such a unique orchestra. I mean, for people who are watching that don't realize this, there's a strong connection with Mahler and Strauss. I mean, yeah. Strauss wrote Ein Heldenleben for the Concertgebouw. Mahler conducted there many times. I think, what, the first, fifth, seventh symphonies, at least. Third symphony for sure. And and then there's this really interesting history with Wilhelm Mengelberg, because he was the music director for 50 years.
Yes. Yeah.
And and had kind of an unfortunate end to his career there as well. Can you talk about the history of that orchestra and also the role that plays in the culture of the Netherlands? Because it's a big deal.
Yeah. There. Yes. I think especially the experience the orchestra had with Mahler, and also Mengelberg, who introduced Mahler to the orchestra and invited Mahler many times to conduct his symphonies. I think this influence is still present and is still going on until today. Yeah, and of course the orchestra has changed several times completely, the players, but somehow this heritage, somehow this is staying. After Mengelberg, Bernard Haitink, the other chief conductor, who was there for almost 30 years, he carried on with this Mahler tradition. Yeah, and I think at that time it was not so it was not so common to do this Mahler repertoire. Yeah, because, you know, just check YouTube, and there is an extremely interesting documentary with Leonard Bernstein, and he is conducting the Vienna Philharmonic Orchestra on Mahler 5. And this is a recording from 1976-1977. So it's about 50 years old, 45, 50 years old. And there you can hear that the Vienna Philharmonic, they have no idea about this piece. They have no idea. They sound like a school orchestra. It's terrible. And, you know, Bernstein, he is outrageous, and he's so disappointed, and he starts to scream and to yell at the, and they have no idea. And, you know, at that time, the Concertgebouw already made two complete recordings for gramophone on Mahler symphonies, and already in the 1920s there was a Mahler festival in Amsterdam. So since 100 years this Mahler tradition is going on, and I think it's a very, it had a great impact on the character and on the style of the orchestra.
Were there things that you, once you started playing Mahler with this orchestra, were there things that you learned, like, that you would not have gotten in other orchestras about, this is how we play this? Because it's really only a few generations removed from Mahler himself.
I think especially with Haitink or with other really great Mahler conductors, it's the how their interpretation of rhythm. Yeah, we all know that the fanfare of Mahler 5, where it says you have to play this a bit like a military fanfare. And, you know, for Mahler, the music notation system was too limited. And many times he needed a lot of text to explain what he really wanted. But many times there is no text. You have to find this interpretation about upbeats, about articulation. And I think this is what I learned from the older musicians in the orchestra, listening to them, how they play the rhythm and how freely they do this, sometimes in a very vocal way and sometimes in a very I think Mahler, it has a lot of Jewish aspects, Jewish melodies, which, yeah, they need some flair, and they need some timing, and they need some special pulse and a musical direction. And there I have to think about Tom Stevens when he said, look what is behind the notes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maybe in Mahler it's a little bit different, what you have to look for behind the notes, more in terms of interpretation. Yeah, and I think this is something I learned mostly by listening to the other players. Yeah, who played for 20, 30, 40 years already with all those great conductors. I think this was that was a great experience to learn to play Mahler like the orchestra is doing. And I think all the new players, they had to learn to play Mahler like this, and because of this, it goes on. Yeah, I think it never will get lost.
No, that orchestra has such a unique sound. And weren't there even instances where Mahler changed some things in the score because of the Concertgebouw Hall? Is that right?
Yeah, you know, in the library in the Concertgebouw, there's still there are scores with the handwriting of Mahler, where he made some quotes and made some additions and had some comments about dynamics and we know that Mahler sometimes changed the instrumentation according to the possibility or maybe weaknesses in the orchestra. For example, in the first symphony, this final chorale, this pom 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 tom 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 tom, this final theme in Mahler First Symphony, there is an extra trumpet and trombone part joining joining the horns. Yeah.
Yes.
And he did this for the orchestra in Budapest, where they obviously had a weak horn section. And there he wanted the one trombone and one trumpet player to assist the horn section. And somehow it was included in a new edition. Yeah. So the editor thought, okay, let's make a new edition. I can make money with this new edition with this added trombone and trumpet. But I think it was only for this occasion. I think if you have a good, strong horn section, you shouldn't spoil this great horn section with one trumpet and one trombone. I think that's the way you have to think about all those small adaptations, that it was mostly for a special occasion and for a special reason.
Right. That reason could have been to give the freelance trumpet player an extra check. So, and the same with Strauss, right? I mean, Strauss is a huge deal. I mean, playing Ein Heldenleben at the Concertgebouw must be somewhat different than playing it with other orchestras, I would imagine.
Yeah. You know, and we still use the parts from those days. Yeah, the parts, you know, they are really yellow and they are taped and they are really extremely old parts from 1920, 1930. Yeah. So also the Mahler symphonies, we still use this very old parts. And I think it's so special to play from those parts where, you know, they have been used 80 years ago.
That's amazing.
I think that's
that's incredible. And while we're talking about that group, first I want to talk about your colleague Peter Masseurs. You guys are both solo trumpets in the orchestra.
Yeah.
How did that scheduling work out when you decided? Was there pieces that you each played, or was it we rotated around?
We rotated around, and we could arrange this ourselves. Yeah. So for the next season, we just sit together and we talked about what would you like to play? What would I like to play? And sometimes there was a little bit negotiating. Yeah. What you would like to play? And of course, when there was like a Mahler 5 or Petrushka or Alpine Symphony, of course you both wanted to play. But it never was any problem. It was quite easy to do this, to divide the programs with each other. I think what was typical that a chief conductor had no influence on this. Yeah. So the chief conductor, Chailly or later Marius Jansons, they could not say, I want this player for this piece. Yeah. Maybe they tried, but, you know, that was like for the orchestra a no-go area. They had to deal with the orchestra as it was. Yeah, as the players just organized it.
Now, were there certain pieces where you were both playing, or was it always he's on this week, I'm off, that kind of thing?
Yeah, it was on-off, yeah. Sometimes, you know, like an Heldenleben, we both played, and one played the first E-flat part, and another one played the first B-flat part. Or when we played Rite of Spring, always we played together, and one was playing the D-trumpet, the piccolo, and the other one was playing the first trumpet. Or in offstage in Mahler 3, somebody played the post horn and somebody played in the orchestra. So there were several programs where we played together. But in a normal setting, we was just one of us was playing.
Right. And talk about a little bit of the instrument choices at that point. I know that now it seems like there's more rotary trumpet coming into repertoire where there might not have been that way 20 years ago. Yeah. Would you have played Strauss on a piston trumpet?
Yes. Also Mahler.
Mahler,
we also played on piston valve trumpets.
Yeah.
And I remember, I think it was in the early 90s, mid-90s, that conductors more and more asked for rotary valve trumpets for Bruckner or for the German repertoire. And yes, I remember that not all my trumpet colleagues were very enthusiastic to play on rotary valves. Yeah. And Peter Masseurs not at all. He said, this is not a German orchestra and we were not playing rotary valves. So he was, and he actually, he never liked playing on rotary valves. And so it turned out that later I did most of the rotary valve repertoire playing. Yeah, because he didn't like it so much. And he said, oh, you can play this Bruckner and you can play this Brahms or whatever. He was always happy not having to do it. Yeah. So, and yeah, we it was a nice arrangement. I liked it. I liked to play on the rotary valves. Yeah. Yeah. So it was a good arrangement like this. Yeah.
It's interesting because I was talking to a friend of mine yesterday. You know, Ed Tarr wrote that book, The Trumpet. And he says that in Vienna, during Mahler's time, they were playing French Bessons. They weren't playing rotaries.
Exactly.
So sometimes the educated conductors are not quite as educated at that.
Yeah. But you know, there are many trumpet players from the German or Austrian, they just don't believe this. Yeah. So when they say to me, why don't you use rotary valves for Mahler? Because many times they think that that's the original trumpet. And then I say, you know, in Mahler's time, they used French Bessons. And that's exactly the same instrument Vincent Bach took to the United States, and copied a French Besson. Because they used these trumpets those days in Vienna. So the sound of the trumpets Mahler had in his mind and he heard over there in Vienna was the French Besson. To say that you should play Mahler on a rotary valve, it's actually not true. Although I don't care. I think this whole discussion about what to play on which trumpet, I think it's overrated extremely. It's, you know, a great trumpet player sounds great on everything. Yeah,
yes.
I remember I heard the Chicago Symphony in the must be maybe the mid 90s. They played on rotary valves on a Bruckner symphony. I think it was Bruckner 8. And I saw them playing on rotary valves, but they sounded like Vincent Bach trumpets. Absolutely.
That's right. That's right. It's more about what's in your head than in your hand sometimes, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. They were so connected to this vibrant, resonant Bach sound that, you know, even the different trumpet couldn't change this strong imagination about sound.
So could you talk about the music directors, Chailly, Marius Jansons, Gatti, and Haitink also?
Yeah.
Maybe compare and contrast those.
Haitink, he was a great musician. And he was not a dictator. He was very humble. And I remember the first program I played with Haitink was Shostakovich 8. Yeah, was the first program I played as a principal with Haitink. And I remember this big solo in the third, this he just let me play in the rehearsal and he stopped the orchestra and he said, okay, play one more time so I can listen to your tempo. And he just let me play my tempo. He didn't change anything. He didn't say go faster or slower or and he was very how can I say, easy on this kind of things. Yeah, he never dictated a tempo. So I think it was great to play with Haitink.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he was not the conductor to rehearse and to rehearse. He liked to play and he liked to listen to the orchestra. It was a very nice take and give, this process. While Chailly was more demanding, and Chailly was more a technician. And I remember we played the Rite of Spring with many conductors, including Scholti and Esa-Pekka Salonen, and with Zubin Mehta, with many great conductors. And I must say, Chailly was absolutely the best for Rite of Spring. It was absolutely, it was like, so precise and so reliable and so exact, yeah, in his tempos. He was maybe for Brahms and for Bruckner, he was not so poetic. He was not so round and easygoing like Haitink. But I think, and also opera was great with Chailly, absolutely, yeah. But sometimes he could insist a little bit too much on going faster or slower. So you always had to be very careful to stay with him.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think Marius Jansons, the last chief conductor I experienced in Concertgebouw Orchestra, he was right in the middle. Yeah. He was insisting in a certain way. But also, when he heard that somebody's playing was good, he just left you alone. You could do, yeah. So he was, for me, Jansons was the greatest conductor I ever played with. For me, he was absolutely top.
Yeah. What repertoire did you enjoy playing with him the most?
With Jansons, Shostakovich. Yeah, Shostakovich. The Russian repertoire, Shostakovich was great. But also Strauss, yeah, like Heldenleben or yeah, Brahms was beautiful,
yeah.
Yeah, so and I must say, like Rite of Spring was not so, yeah, you know, in this last part with the changing meters, it was not so, you know, reliable and so perfect as we used to do this with Chailly.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I think he was, Jansons was a great musician, and he was always dealing with the music. He was never dealing with himself as a person. He was, you know, very hardworking and he was also, I remember that sometimes he said, I'm sorry for the concert yesterday. I was not so concentrated. I have to do this better tonight. And we thought, oh, it was great yesterday. So he was very critical about himself. And sometimes he was not happy. Sometimes he stopped the orchestra and the orchestra and said, I have to be more clear. This was not together. It was my fault. Please give me another chance. And so I think that was really great. And I think only the greatest in the world, they behave like this.
Yes. Wow, that's... What part are you playing on the Jansons Heldenleben recording?
The E flat, the first E flat trumpet.
Yeah, that's such a terrific recording. If anybody wants to get a good sample of that time, what are some of the favorite recordings you had with Jansons? Mahler 5 was with him, right?
Mahler 5, Mahler 3, post horn,
yep.
Solo. I think we did Shostakovich 8 with Jansons, Poem of Ecstasy, I think also.
Was there Petrushka with him as well?
Yeah, Petrushka also. Petrushka, there's a Petrushka with Jansons. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, this is an example also how Jansons was. We did a few concerts, and then I met Jansons backstage, and then he said to me, he said, Fritz, the ballerina, could you play a little bit slower? Yeah. Ta-ta-tum, pa-pa-pum, 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 yeah. And then I said, yeah, I could, but you know, I want to play in one breath. And when I play that slow, I might have a problem at the end. And he said, oh, you play one breath? Okay, your tempo. Yeah. And then the next concert, I remember very well, the drum starts, yeah, pa pa pa, rum, ta 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 ta, and he put his stick down, and like this, and he just let me choose my own tempo.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. No wonder everybody loved him.
Yeah, he was very helpful, and you know, I remember playing Mahler 5. He asked me, he said, "What do you want? You want to have?" You need the upbeat for the beginning, or you want to start on your own? And I said, I don't know. Let's see what happens. And yeah, he just let me play. And yeah, so he was so, for me, he was easy. He was easy.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I know in situations where he could be really demanding, where he couldn't get the sound or the idea he had in his mind, and then he could be really insisting. Yeah, so but I think it was all human. Jansons, that's why I liked him so much. For example, the beginning of the Bartok concerto, the three trumpets, like ba 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 ba. Yeah, this. I remember he said, "Trumpets, you know, it should be very soft. I know it should be very soft, but I give you a nice big cue, and you play as soft as you can." And it was so helpful to have this big cue instead of like this, and to just just move your pinky for the entrance, like many conductors do. And how can you start with three trumpets? And he knew exactly how to do this. Yeah. And many times he said to the brass, if possible, can you play a little bit softer? If not possible, then it's okay. But maybe a little bit. But he never asked for the impossible. Yeah. And because he was so realistic in his, in his questions, you did the best you could. Yeah, and I think that was a unique quality of Jansons in his way to deal with the orchestra, and in his way to give confidence and to give responsibility to the players in the orchestra. I think, wow. For me, it was great, absolutely great. Great conductor.
And then you had a little bit of time with Gatti as well toward the end, right?
Yeah.
And there's also a Mahler 5 on the Concertgebouw website of Gatti and you playing Principal in Mahler 5.
Yeah. That was my last week in the orchestra. That was my last concert.
That's a way
this
to go
Mahler
out.
5. Yeah, that was my last concert, this Mahler 5 with Gatti. Yeah.
Did they program that way on purpose?
No. 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 No, it was just coincidence, yeah.
Wow. So what? We were talking a little bit before we came on about why you left the orchestra. It was just you didn't want to go in there forever. Is that mostly what it was?
Yes. I was already teaching in Amsterdam at the university, and more and more I liked the teaching, and I think everything worked quite well with my students. They were quite successful. They won auditions. And so somehow I could notice that it was working very well, and that I could do a good job with the students. And also remembering Tom Stevens' words that you should know when to leave the orchestra. And, you know, I also have seen some older colleagues suffering in the orchestra, and most of them themselves noticed too late that it was not good anymore. And I wanted to avoid this situation, not only for myself but also for the orchestra, because I think this orchestra needs players in their best shape with the best possible quality. And I have seen some situations where many people thought, it's about time to leave for this person. Yeah. And then they struggled on for another couple of months or years. Yeah. And I think that's a very difficult situation for everybody. Yeah. So, and I absolutely wanted to avoid this situation. And, yes, I wanted to go. Also, I wanted to go out to go to a different country. I wanted to go out of the Netherlands, and this possibility to have this teaching job here in Zurich at the university. That was an opportunity I wanted to take. Yeah. Right. So, and I was exactly 50 when I. 50 years when I left the orchestra, and maybe now I say maybe I would have stayed a couple of more years because I missed it a lot when I left the orchestra. I missed it extremely. I never would expect that I would miss the orchestra so much. my colleagues and the hall and the tours and this great music. Yeah. So now it's okay. It's now 10 years ago, but you know, you cannot organize your life. Yeah. Things come and go, and you have to take the opportunity once it's there. Yeah. So.
Right. Sounds very similar to Gabor Tarkovi leaving Berlin to go to his teaching job. It's exactly the same age, same situation, right?
Yes, yeah. I talked with Gabor 1 or 2 years ago in a summer course here in Switzerland. We were both teaching and playing there. And he said, you know, I did exactly what you did. I'm 50 years quitting from the Berlin Philharmonic. So, he had the same reason that he didn't want to stay forever. And and I must say, honestly, it's a very demanding job being principal trumpet in an orchestra like this. Yeah, I liked it a lot. I enjoyed it a lot. But, you know, I didn't want to take any risk about, you know, becoming weak in my playing and not realizing it myself. So that was a little bit my. Like I said, remembering Tom Stevens' words, I thought, okay, that's enough for me. And I had almost 30 years of orchestra playing, and I think that for me it was enough.
Yeah, yeah. And now you're teaching in Zurich. How many students do you have right now?
I have 14 students.
14 students. So what is the situation there at the school? Is it... Is it similar? You have a master class, private lessons every week? Or are there orchestral coaching?
Yeah, a little bit of everything. They have actually 90 minutes of individual private lessons and 90 minutes every week. And then we have group lessons on basics, or we do a trumpet section, orchestral repertoire, or we do a trumpet ensemble, or we have a group lesson with a pianist on solo repertoire. So we have many group activities besides the individual lessons.
Yeah. What things do you notice in students consistently, with your own students or when you go out and do master classes, that are sort of holes in their playing that you see as very common?
Not being organized in their practice. That's what I noticed many times. Because I think sometimes they are overwhelmed with all the information, with all the methods, with all the books, with all the videos, and with all the stuff they have access to, that sometimes they cannot organize themselves. It's too much. Yeah. And they, yeah, you need to choose what to do and what not to do. Right. And I think this is where many times students struggle with, to find a good working system in their practice strategy, what to do and what not to do.
What do you find helps the students get organized the most? How would you have them lay their day out?
I asked them to write down, to keep a diary on their practice, what they do and which methods or which exercises they do for how many times. So they, I think, when you write something down, you have to think about it. And I think when you look back after 1 week to see what you have done and during the week, sometimes you notice that there is an inconsistency or some things you could improve or you should change.
Right.
Yeah. And I think organization is extremely important. And I must say, I learned this from Tom Stevens, who was an extremely organized and very strict person. Yeah. And I think without this, I think it's very difficult to follow a plan and to achieve your goals.
Yeah. Do you have students play fundamentals on B flat or C trumpet, or do you find? I've seen pictures of you playing a lot of B flat now. You know.
Yeah. 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 I changed. I must say, in the last weeks, I I always play my warming up on the C trumpet. We change, sometimes in the group, when we have a group warming up, we use B flats or C, it just depends. But there is a lot of B flat playing for basics, which I think is a good choice.
Yeah, and also obviously in your teaching, you've written a lot of books, so everybody should go to fritzdamrow.com, and there's there's so much there, and some of them I have, and some are on the way, but... The Fitness for Brass was a book that you did several years ago that's been very familiar to a lot of people. Were those your arms on the front of Fitness for Brass?
No. Actually, I was absolutely not happy about this cover because it shows so much like physical strength and power, which I think it's only one side of the trumpet playing, but... You know, the publisher said, you know, this is an eye catcher, and this is a good idea to. So, you know, this Fitness for Brass, it's now more than 20 years, and my idea was actually to put something together also for the not so advanced players, and to have a collection of exercise that covers the whole. All aspects of playing, warming up, and like endurance and fingering, articulation, flexibility, intervals, double tonguing, a little bit of everything. It was first published in the Dutch language, right. And then later they made translations into English and French and I think Spanish and German. And in the beginning I remember that the publisher from the Husker, they were not so enthusiastic about this book. They said, you know, all those boring exercises, we're not really sure if people will buy this. And actually, it's since then it has been quite good selling book. Still it's
and the most recent book you had out like that is the Shape Up book, which it's a terrific book, and the exercises online look really great. And for people that don't know, you demonstrate so many of them, and it's even if you don't speak the same language, it's very clear what you're going after with those.
Yeah. Yes, you know, I'm very interested in basics, in how to practice and what to practice, and I still want to fine tune my own playing and my own ideas about what to practice, how to practice. I think that's a never ending story, and I'm still very curious to keep developing my ideas and my approach and my efficiency on my own playing, and also to have some influence on the process and the playing of my students.
Right. And for people that don't know, also you have the Siber Vocalises, a book of Conconi Vocalises, all with accompaniment of you playing, and then without, with just piano, and Bach for trumpet. There's so many festive Baroque, festive Christmas. I think there's like 10 titles or something like that. But they're great books, and people should really, really check those out. And along with your solo recordings. So I think the one that you can find on iTunes is the one I listened to, that has the Carl Pils Sonata and some of the other more Dachshund-oriented pieces. Yeah. Do you have any plans for any new recordings?
Yeah. For several years, I have plans. But I think we all know that this whole CD market somehow imploded quite completely. I'm not sure if it's a good idea to launch a new CD. Maybe it should be something that's only online available as a download or as a streaming product. I'm still thinking about this to do this. Yeah, but I'm not sure about the repertoire, and so it's not so easy.
I mean, so much of your repertoire that I've heard you record is very romantic repertoire, the Russian repertoire, the Carl Pils and things like that. What kind of things were you thinking about doing? Hindemith or any of the standard things, or did you have some new pieces in mind?
Maybe I would like to do some different pieces. I have a bunch of Russian music that never has been recorded before, and I have some very old French music that never has been recorded before, not even published, like handwritten, original handwritten parts. So I'm thinking about to do something like this. So like lesser known repertoire that hopefully has enough quality to put it on a CD or to make a recording out of it.
Wow. Well, it's great. You definitely have had a career that's very full between orchestra music, chamber music, soloing, teaching. Is there anything that during this pandemic time that you've kind of discovered or has kept you sane with the trumpet? Because have things been sort of locked down in Switzerland like they have other places?
Yeah. Luckily, we still can teach. Yeah, so I have been to the university today. All the classical lessons and group lessons are canceled. They have to be done online. But the individual instrumental lessons, they can be done in a traditional way, which I'm very happy about. Because last spring, we had to do online teaching for a couple of months. Yeah, which works until a certain degree. But, you know, we all know the problems and we all know the limitations. So I'm happy that that we could go on with the normal lessons. Yes, you know, I have been also talking with my students how they experience this limitations and also the possibilities, like not having the opportunity to play concerts and to play with ensembles and to play with groups and what they think about this and how they deal with the situation and I think also with the future. Yeah, so I think we all don't know exactly what is going to happen in the classical music industry, about the orchestras, about the ensembles, about the possibilities, about how much money will be available, will go on in the classical music industry. Maybe things will change. We don't know. And yeah, somehow musicians they have to find possibilities and answers to this situation. And I must say, I don't have the answers. I don't. It's very complicated, and it's still a very unpredictable situation. And I also know you in the US. I spoke with Dave, the principal trumpet of the Metropolitan Opera. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and yeah, they I think they will not start until summer.
At least, yeah. Two thirds of the musicians have moved out of New York from the Met. It's horrible, and each situation is so different. I mean, some orchestras have done the right thing, and some orchestras, like the Met management, is not. So it's very difficult. But
I must say, during this pandemic, now this period, also for me, many masterclasses and concerts and projects have been canceled over the last year. But I must say, I could keep my playing, I could keep it going. I practice a lot. I still practice a lot. So until now, I could motivate myself to just go on and to keep on going. And now last week I had I confirmed to be part of the International Trumpet Guild conference, and they asked me to do an online concert. Yeah, to record like 20 or 30 minutes of music. So I'm thinking about this now. This will be my next upcoming project to put something together for the ITG conference.
That would be very good. That'd be very good. When we got on, I was telling you the first time I met you was at an ITG conference, but at a bar, of course.
Yeah.
I have to say, I've really enjoyed this conversation. I'm We'll sign off from Facebook in a second, so hang on just a minute. But Frits, thank you so much for doing this, and I really appreciate it. And everybody in the States always admires your playing, and I think they want to know more about you, so I'm sure a lot of people will go back and watch this. And they should all go to fritsdamrow.com and purchase as many of their books as they can afford.
Thank you, Mark, for your invitation. It was a great pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much, Frits. Thank you so much.
Keep it going. Keep it going.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I'll sign off here. Thanks so much for watching, everybody.